Congratulations on Bite Me. It's really a very funny and lovely romantic film.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
It's got a few twists and turns in it, and delightfully so. But wow, you carry this movie on your shoulders, don't you?
Well, nobody carries any movie on their shoulders. Film is the ultimate collaborative art form, but I did a lot of things on it.
Well, you're the screenwriter. Tell me about how you came up with the idea, or was it out of something you read in a newspaper?
No, it's a funnier story than that. So I was acting on the set of Boardwalk Empire, mm-hmm. And got to chatting with one of the extras one day. It was a very long shoot day. And over the course of this day, she revealed to me that she identifies as a vampire. And I was like, what? And then we kept talking, and I came to understand that she's part of this global community of people who identify as vampires. They don't believe they're supernatural. But they believe that they need to drink blood, human blood, to stay healthy or feed on energy. There are sanguinarians, and then there are psychic vampires. But I became completely fascinated by this. And I went home and fell hard down the YouTube rabbit hole of this community, and became just kind of inspired. I mean, fascinated and inspired by the individuals who are part of this identity, because like it's a very rough thing to commit to.
Like, imagine.
A lot of them are disowned by their families, lose friends, or certainly pushed to the fringes of society. But to believe something with such conviction that you'll live your truth even in the face of all of that, I found really inspiring. So I decided to write, and I love romantic comedies deeply. But I feel like they've taken such a horribly sad turn since about the 2000s. And like the 80s and 90s rom-coms were actually good movies, a lot of them. They were smart, they were well-written, they were funny. And now they've just gone like, so I wanted to write a smart romantic comedy.
You did, and you're working opposite some really, really great people. I think that Christian is a dynamite actor. He's got so much charisma.
He does, and he was so amazing to watch on set. I've rarely acted with an actor who has so much precision. Like, he would just come in. He's done so much film acting that he just knows exactly what the camera will pick up on, and he just does like the bare minimum necessary, not in like a lazy way, but just in like a precision way, the bare minimum of to convey what needs to be conveyed. It was amazing to watch him work.
And you guys have such great chemistry together too. I mean, from the audit on, you know, that first, kind of meeting, which is, I was going to say, is a throwback to the 80s, you know, rom-coms. That first meeting, the meet cute is what they used to call.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
they don't all happen in IRS offices. That's a little twist on the meet cute.
Yeah. magnetism there from day one?
Well, so Christian is a big enough deal that his agent wouldn't let us audition him for the role. We had to offer it. We were allowed a one meeting, but we weren't allowed to audition him before offering him the role. And which is tricky with a romantic comedy, because the chemistry is everything, right? If you don't have chemistry between the main characters, you're toast. It doesn't matter how good the script is. And so it was decided that I had to be the one to go to this meeting, because I needed to like try to see, because normally you would have a screen test or something and see if it's there, but we weren't gonna get that. And so I went to this meeting to like kind of try to feel it out, if we could play off each other. And I guessed right.
I think you did too. Going back to this, I know big actors that still audition for stuff. So I've never heard of an agent saying, well, no, you have to offer them the part.
Oh yeah, they say that all the time, but it's never the actor. Like, I'm sure if we'd been able to talk to Christian at that time, he would have been like, "Of course I'll, you know, I'll do a test with you." But you know, it's all like agents and power broking and whatever.
You know, I became really good friends over the last few days with the other Naomi in this, and she is such a delight. You know, and I'm a fan of hers from American Horror Story. And she, playing the role of Chrissy, did such a great job in this. I mean, it was one of those, you know, I go back to the 1950s now, you know, and to those, you know, kooky comedies with like Tony Randall being the best friend. And every time he's on scene, he buoys the whole film up. And I think that's what you've got with Naomi Grossman.
I agree. Well, and so finally, we have a mutual friend. I'd never met her. But we have a mutual friend, and she'd been sort of in my head. And as I was writing the script, she just kept appearing as Chrissy. So I was really writing the script with her in my head. And then but I didn't know her. And so we did various workshops of the script over a number of years with different actors to see if it was working. And the whole script worked except that part, because we didn't have Naomi Grossman. There's this thing that's needed for that. I mean, she has this like just kinetic energy. I mean, she's like, I love her. She's like insane, but she has this sort of like kinetic energy and humor and like that nobody else has. And so I kept like through the workshops, people were like, what about Chrissy? And I'm like, I know, but it would work if we had Naomi Grossman. And so luckily then I wrote her a great letter and she agreed to do it.
Again, that's part luck, but you know, part I really do think that the universe works in your favor sometimes, you know, because it's a good script. We've all been waiting for stuff like this to come out because it isn't out there anymore.
I know, which is so sad because like romantic comedies are great, and there's something so satisfying about the formula of them. And I'm not saying, I don't think our film is formulaic in this. I mean, it's a very different kind of romantic comedy. It's edgy, but there is the formula to romantic comedies, just in the sense of like the meet cute and then, you know, the love grows and then they get broken up and then, you know, and like there's something that's so profoundly satisfying about that to watch. Particularly right now, like when everything is uncertain about the world and sad, and like to like get to go on this ride but with the certainty that they're going to get together in the end, and you're going to have that sort of heartbreak, you know, swelling feeling as she runs through the streets to get him, I find extremely satisfying.
This portion of Screen Chatter is presented by VP Dental. Check out our great dental plan starting at just $16 per month. Do you enjoy your job as a writer or an actress? Which one do you prefer?
I really hope I get to keep doing both of them. They both scratch a very similar itch and provide different nutrition, because I mean I experience them both as kind of a channeling, if that makes sense. Like in both cases you're sort of like surrendering yourself to a different person, which is I find to be a very enjoyable and interesting experience. But then writing's a very solitary endeavor. It's a lot of hours of room alone in a room with the characters in your head, but it's very amazing in that you get to be a wizard, you know, you get to like write these worlds and characters and props that then grown people later will become and build, and you know, it's like, it's amazing. But then also getting to be an actor and getting to live out the story in your body and play in the world that you imagined is also amazing.
Did you already have yourself in mind for the role in this, for Sarah?
Yes. Well, if you're an actress and a writer, why would you not write yourselves the best role you can imagine?
I was just asking. You know, because I know a lot of people. Well, yeah, I went out and I couldn't find anybody, so I did it, you know. And
No.
As an actress, though, do you follow any particular kind of method? Have you been trained in certain things?
Yeah, so I went to the American Academy of Dramatic Arts in New York City, which is a 2-year conservatory program, and they are, it's very much a sort of sampler platter approach to the training. So you learn Stanislavski one semester, you learn
Meisner.
Meisner, you know, the different ones, Lecoq. So I think what they encourage, and I've taken, is sort of like, take what works from you from each method and then kind of let the rest go. It's interesting acting in things you write in, because a lot of Stanislavski is doing the homework, you know, of like, doing all the biography and spending time sort of learning these characters. And on scripts I've written, I've spent like 4 years living with this character that I'm then going to play. So I've already done all of that prep very deeply. So then it's really more about like figuring out how to switch from a writer's brain into an actor's body. For Sarah, she's probably the most different character from me that I've ever played. And so I, from like an energetic level, you know, she consumes space. She doesn't care what people think. She, or at least she pretends to. She secretly really does, but you know, she moves through the world as if she doesn't. And so I actually spent a month before the film in her clothes and with the blue hair and with the face tattoo, just existing in New York City as her, because I needed to feel what it felt like. Like, how does the world respond to you differently when you look like that? And it was a very, very interesting experience.
I would imagine, you know, Gwyneth Paltrow did that in Shallow Hal. She walked around in the complete, you know, heavy makeup and found out that people are treated like crap, you know. What did you find out?
So people were very aggressive with me, which... they're not normal. I mean, you know, normally I look like sort of a nice white lady, and people are generally pretty nice to me.
Look like there's pies in the oven right now.
Yeah. but as her, they were some verbally and sometimes physically aggressive towards me, and felt like a weird entitlement to comment on my choices. Like, people would sit, come up and say, like, you're so pretty, like, how could you do that to your face with the face tattoo? And it was like this, and would make assumptions about me that were so funny to experience, because I knew, like, I was playing a character, but then they would assume these things about me as a person. So I really started developing that sort of 30-yard stare that she has, first because of just like safety issues, because if I didn't look that aggressive, people would be aggressive to me. So I needed to look so tough that you wouldn't mess with me, just in order to like move safely around New York City, which was really interesting.
It all goes into that saying that a lot of times your costume and makeup really does inform your character. I mean, you know, a lot of actors and actresses can't really get into their character 100% until they don the costume.
Absolutely. Well, because it affects, I mean, the clothes you choose to wear affect your everything, you know?
Hmm. And speaking of that, you have some great costumes in this. you really lucked out with whoever it was that was doing your costumes.
Well, so the woman who did the costumes, it was actually my best friend since we were 13.
Oh, wow.
And she's not primarily a costume designer. She's an amazing director and writer in her own right. But because she's my best friend, but she had done costumes as sort of like a money gig and otherwise before this. And so because she's my best friend, she agreed to come do costumes for us. But it was so fun to get to work with her, and she just did such an amazing job. I mean, the ballroom scene and the vampire outfits, and she just knocked it out of the park.
Talk to me a little bit about 79 Parts.
Oh, yeah.
What an incredible movie.
Yeah. So I only played a very small part in that film, but Ari Taub directed it, and he decided to shoot as much as he could with the money he had. So normally when you're raising money for a film, you wait until you've raised the whole sum and then shoot the whole movie in one go. The advantage of which is getting to shoot the whole movie in one go, the disadvantage of which is that you often have to wait many years till you have all that money. So he decided he would just shoot the movie. Like, if he had the money for one scene, we'd shoot that scene. And then, and so we shot it over like maybe 10 years. That may be a slight over exaggeration, but not much. And so, yeah, so it was a wild ride.
Over the years, I've been on many sets and, you know, acted and whatever. And I always come away with loving the crew more than I love my co-stars in a lot of cases. They really, you know, they do so much and their advice is usually like little gold bricks.
Hmm. Yeah.
Was that the case with your crew on Bite?
We had the loveliest crew, which I would like to note was more than 50% female and more than 50% non-white, which I feel very proud of.
Good for you, yeah.
No, it was so lovely. And I've had this experience on the sets of all of my movies so far, which is that there's such, and I think this is the 50% women, the more than 50% women is related to this, that they feel like so much warmer, safer, lovelier spaces than sets normally feel, that day player actors come on and are like, what is happening on this set? Like, everyone's so nice. People aren't yelling at each other.
Like, this is in college. Yeah.
So yeah, it was so lovely. And there was one, we had one PA, Milton Gwanga, who had such a, it was like one of his early set experiences. And it's such a wonderful time that he made us this like 5-minute behind the scenes video after we wrapped, as like a, as to like commemorate the experience, and that I still cry every time I watch it because it's so sweet.
I can't let you go without asking you about Boardwalk Empire, because that was such an amazing series. And did you work with my cousin Steve Buscemi?
No, I played Bob's secretary.
Oh,
it was, well, yeah.
Again, wow.
Yeah. No, I mean, it was such an amazing show and cultural moment, and it was so amazing to get to be part of it. I'm one of the few women who was on that show without having to take her clothes off, which I feel kind of proud about.
Yeah, that's why I never visit the set, because they want me to, and I can't. But, you know, they had that beautiful cast, an incredible series of people directing, and then, on top of everything else, it's shot in that noir style that just blows me away every time I rerun an episode.
Yeah, no, it's such an amazing show.
What did you learn a lot from that set?
I did. Well, it was my first time being on a TV set of that scale. And it was amazing to watch Tim Van Patten directed when I was on it, and getting to watch him work with it was like watching an octopus with like all of these arms that he had to wield in these different ways, all while being willing to talk to the actors, and all while, you know, it's just, you're at the center of a machine directing a show of that size.
Tim is a very calm person.
Yes.
You know? And I think you need that to be a director. Now, he comes from a showbiz family. We all, you know, yeah, we know that he's part of the Van Pattens. Learning that makes him more empathetic as a director, I think.
Absolutely. And it was amazing to, part of the octopus thing was watching him, you know, in every 10 minutes there would be like 30 people who would ask him a question, but each time he answered a question he would be fully present with that person, and then they would go away and then he'd look at you, and then, you know, like after 29 people he'd get to me as the actor and he'd say something, and then he'd walk into the other. It was just like, it was an, like a masterclass in just concentration and focus and like.
But look at you guys on Bite Me. You did Bite Me for the catering budget of, you know, one episode of Boardwalk Empire.
Don't even get me started. my friend just did reshoots on a studio film. And like 2 days of reshoots was $1 million, which, you know, for an indie film would be an amazing budget. And it's a bit depressing when you start breaking it down that way.
As a single mom, I want to make sure my kids have healthy teeth. Going to the dentist can be expensive. Just a simple cleaning can cost over $100. Then I found TDA. And for about $1 a day, Total Dental Administrators covers my family on over 200 dental procedures. Whether you're an individual, a family, self-employed, or retired, your acceptance is guaranteed for one of these policies. Call or click for your free information kit and see how affordable dental health can be.
Naomi, it is such a pleasure to chat with you. You know, I think you should hire only Naomis from now on.
I'm working on it. Yes.
And I can't wait for your next project. Write something. Keep going because you're good at it.
Thank you so much.
It is a pleasure.
Okay. Thank you for having me.
Thank you. And enjoy your hotel room. Bye-bye.
Okay, bye.